It's the calm before the storm, isn't it? So let's use this time very, very wisely. We have this comet coming in, Comet Zion. And it was pointed out to me by one of the viewers that this comet is going to arrive here exactly 666 years to the time when the great comet Negra, the black comet, arrived that supposedly triggered the Black Plague in Europe. At least it coincided with it. And it also brought an enormous amount of devastation to the people on the planet, which hasn't been reported very much. 666 years. So, this comets have always been thought to correlate with great shakeups on the planet. And this is the tale that history tells us. And just because the eggheads say, we don't know, doesn't mean it doesn't happen. In other words, just because scientists says they don't know, does that mean that things stop happening? No, it means that they haven't figured it out yet. Well, maybe lots of people have figured it out. Maybe scientists are the slowpokes among us, the nerds who have to calculate everything instead of spiritually intuit. You see, they're idiot savants. They're backwards, sort of trying to do it backwards, as it were. So we know that throughout history, the tale of history says comets coincide with big, big shakeups. They shake the solar system up. They change dynamics. They bring about changes. Stuff happens. And eventually science will catch up. But we don't have time to wait for them to catch up. We have to assume and listen to the spiritual intuitives and say, okay, what's going on now? After more and more work on that dream that I had that was so, so important, that talked about two collapses and then a third collapse. And the third one just being unbelievably terrible. Working on that, actually going to the location that was shown to me in the dream and assessing the situation, it seems, I would say it's leaning more and more and more towards that dream is a portent, was a showing of World War III. Okay. Everything fits with World War III. And it is going to be devastating beyond belief. Why? As some of the viewers have pointed out, this war is going to be fought in a very different way. It's going to be using beams, various types of beams from space, all sorts of, you know, concentrated beams of energy to bring about devastating effects. Many, many, many weapon systems that we're not told about, we're not aware about. Only those who have dug deeply into this are kind of aware of the various weapon systems that they have now. But I guarantee you that they have so many, many weapon systems we don't even know about at this point in time. Now, I watched a video a while ago of amazing video. I would say maybe the most crucial video there's ever been made. And it had to do with this very close assistant to Dwight Eisenhower, President Eisenhower. And this assistant was dying when he made the video. And he had been sworn to secrecy for his whole life, but he was going to die very soon. And he decided that he was going to spill the beans. And he made this video that talked about what really happened with the Eisenhower administration, because he was there and he was completely involved in what happened between Eisenhower and Area, 51, whatever, out there in Nevada. You know what I'm talking about. And the black ops and the military-industrial complex and their involvement with extraterrestrials. And he spilled the beans, and now we know if this person is believable, and I would say he is, because it all fits very, very, very clearly. The depth of development of technology is far beyond what we realize, actually. And it is most definitely connected with extraterrestrials sharing their technology out of sight of the public, out of sight of the press, out of sight of even the President of the United States and Congress. So when Dwight Eisenhower left office, he said, look, the greatest threat to this country, and it's a very severe threat, is the military-industrial complex. And it was a code word. It was a code word that he was talking about. He was talking about what he found out about the military-industrial complex involvement with extraterrestrials, and the technology that they were developing, and the fact that they had designed a shadow world government, a shadow world control system, and that they were going behind the backs of the Constitution, of the people, of the world, and doing all this massive development secretly to institute global power and control, etc. Now, what I was shown in this amazing dream, terrifying really, was I was shown a collapse of stability. It was the first collapse of stability. And it was like, whoa, all this turmoil and dust up happened. But it settled down, the dust settled, the turmoil settled, and then there was a period of calm. And then a little farther along this area, a little farther along, another collapse happened. And again, it was like, wow, this is terrible, all this dust and turmoil. And then that settled down. Then a little further along, a little further along, a little further along, suddenly this entire massive wall, mountain collapsed, really. An entire mountainside collapsed. And the dust and the boulders and the turmoil was so terrible, it made the other two collapses look like they were nothing. And so, how could this be possible? If what I think is the first collapse was World War I, second collapse I saw was World War II, the third collapse I saw is going to be World War III. How is it possible that anything could be so terrible? And it's because of these weapon systems that have been developed, coming from space. You know, as Ronald Reagan, President Reagan said, "Hey, you know, the next big threat we're gonna face, it may come from space." You know, like, what? From extraterrestrial space, what's he talking about? And then he has all these Star Wars programs, you see, and what is going on, all right? The weaponization of space. But there's more to it than that. There are the beams, the electromagnetic pulses, EMPs. There's so much stuff that can be utilized now. We're going to be caught unawares by it. We keep thinking about, you know, people shooting at each other behind, you know, street warfare and stuff like that. It was just, no. It's not like that. There's different weapons have been developed now. They haven't, you know, in some places they tested them out a little bit. High frequency, all these frequencies and remote, affecting people at like a remote control at remote distances. But in a lot, and just a totally different type of conflict and war, so different. So, what I saw was I was able to get away from it. And interestingly enough, today I was just asking for some sort of show me what's going to happen. You know, I needed a direction and an awareness, and I was At the dump, and this dump truck came, and they dumped this massive load of, they'd torn off the roof of a house, and it created this massive dust cloud, just hideous dark dust, horrible dust. And I said, oh my gosh. And I'm right next to it. And it kept dumping. But the amazing thing was, there was a very strong wind. And the wind pushed every bit of away from me, entirely away from me. And none of the dust even touched me. As I said, wow. That means I was on the right side of the situation. Now, a dust up, as you know, means a very, very vicious fight. And so in the symbology of just a tremendous amount of dust, if you look at it symbolically, from a spiritual level, a dust up means just a tremendous fight, turmoil, where there's so much dust rising that nobody can figure out what the heck's going on. It's just a free-for-all, terrible fight. So, unfortunately, what I see is that World War III is going to happen. And I believe there are a lot of those who have seen intuitively in the future who also have said the same thing. Like, I think Nostradamus said something about a World War III. There are plenty of people who have spoken about a great World War III that is just going to be terrible beyond belief. And I would have to say that it looks like that is going to happen. And it may coincide with this comet, whatever it is that's coming in. Scientists are now saying, gee, you know, changes in the weather affect people, affect levels of violence and stuff. Oh, really? You know, yeah, duh. I mean, stuff, our environment, changes in environment do, you know, cause and bring about changes. How about that? So we're now being told, I mean, our behavior can change according to what's going on in the climate, what's going on in various parameters. Hey, well, comets can bring about, can trigger a lot of changes, subtle changes, various changes that definitely can affect the behavior of humans. They definitely can trigger wars. They can trigger more and more agitation. Okay. And what I have seen is that without question, the world has been spiritually debased. It's lost its spiritual foundation, and it's gone into what I call animism, which is worshiping the flesh, worshiping the animal nature, and believing that that is somehow exalted, and that is what we are, and that we need to follow its dictates, which in other words, getting into the reptilian brain. You know, we have several brains, one on top of the other, and it means abandoning the higher clarifications and sinking down into the reptilian brain, becoming very animalistic, very shamanistic, oriented in ways that most definitely lead to conflict, most definitely. What I've seen is the entire planet has been lowered down in its vibrations, and it's and crazily enough, as this was happening, we're getting all this talk about how the planet's vibrations are raising up and we're becoming a spiritual planet. It is utter nonsense. It's exactly the opposite has happened. It's just astonishing what I have seen over the last week. I had an opportunity to really evaluate it. I went on a trip, and it's as if the higher clarification, sensibilities, awareness, everything that the spiritual, you know, domain has vanished. I didn't see even a tiniest shred of it in all my travels and viewing people and situations. There, not even a shred of it. It's vanished. And another way of looking at it too, if you are sensitive, you know, auditorily sensitive, and you know about music and how music is used, you can't help but realize that the background music, just the soundtrack, that wherever you go, in a store, watching the television, movies, and in your car, the radio, there's always some sort of music, audio going on, right? It's all so prevalent. Just listen to it. And you can't help but realize that it's a very violent, militaristic type of music. And the sounds are sounds almost like of combat, of the soundtracks and all the sound effects that we're getting. Violent, violent, boom, clank, 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 mechanistic. It's like the sounds of war. It is so far away from what the higher spiritual sensibilities would want to listen to. It's like the opposite. This should, you know, for those who know how to read the musical tea leaves, you know that this is a very, very unmistakable sign of a debased civilization. And I've tried my whole life to tell people, listen to great music. You got to listen to great music. And no, the effort to brainwash and debase the world, it has a blueprint which is really, really powerful and deceitful. So people have just gotten used to this horrible, horrible music. Where was I? I was a member in some store somewhere. It was a restaurant, maybe the food. I said, hey, you know, it's good food, but the music was like horrible. Something like I wanted to throw up, you know, it was so revolting. Yeah, what was it? It was some kind of, you know, a lot of rap music and it just, you know, thuggish stuff. But it goes beyond that thuggish debase, just slimy type of stuff, violent stuff. It's also all the sound effects are violent sound effects and kind of stuff you would associate with marching armies and combat and all this stuff, and super adrenalized, super saturated with activated what do you would call it, agitation, very, very high agitation, and like the soft, smooth, beautiful, elevated stuff, you know, you don't hear it anymore. It's gone. It's absolutely gone. Unfortunately, very unfortunate. So, you can look at the body language, everybody. You can look at the way people dress. You can look at their gestures. You know, the way they talk and just all the gestures, everything. Everything is animalistic. You don't see the true graciousness. You don't see the true mellowness, the sparkling intelligence of calmness and mellowness and the alive... the aliveness of a spiritualized, you know, mind is not there at all. You just look and say, wow, it's not there. I don't see anybody. And then just the massive amount of tattoos that people have now. I mean, it's just incredible what I saw. I mean, I went through some places that I said, I got to get out of this place. I mean, you could just, meth addicts all over the place. And you know, tattoos just like going from their face, wrapping around their neck of some ferocious dragon, you know, and then all sorts of occult symbols of death and death skulls all over the place. And just like, is this Dante's Inferno, you know? And the way, the coarseness of mannerisms and dress is astonishing. What's even more astonishing is the complete feeling like this is normal. And that anyone who's not this way is abnormal, and the idea, the complete acceptance of this by society, that is what's more astonishing. I mean, in the past, that would have been utterly unacceptable, you know. Polite civilization, polite society, you know, completely unacceptable, and those people, you know, couldn't have shown their faces anywhere. And now they're strutting around like they own the place. You know, hey, isn't tolerance great, you know? This is what it's. This is a child of tolerance here. It's a child of saying, "Hey, if anything goes, if it, you know, if it feels good, if it's animalistic, if it, the flesh wants to do it, just do it. You know, that's okay." So I came away from this experience of evaluation, seeing that there's really, nothing. Going on for the world. The world's got nothing going on for it. It's got nothing in its favor right now. Nothing. And something like a comet coming in can destabilize. It's a very destabilizing thing. It can be. And you have the destabilization of it has just been a comedy of errors. In fact, you might even say it's been a blueprint of intentional mismanagement, intentional bad decisions, all going towards, you know, some terrible global conflict. By design. It's by design. It's by design. Designed to collapse the world civilization and wipe it out so a new one can take its place, governed by the ideas of the ETs and the puppets that serve them. So the situation coming up, I mean, the comet is coming in. You've got situations deteriorating across the Middle East. You have no will to resist it, and you've got no leadership whatsoever in the world, devoid of leadership. Bumbling fools everywhere. That's a recipe for disaster. You know, and I would just say, I would like to find someone that I can follow, you know, say, well, who can we follow right now? Who can we follow is the question. Who do you trust? Who do you trust to say that knows, you know, that knows the way to peace, to safety? So we have to find somebody that we can trust, we can follow. I mean, it just, where? Just think about it. Where do you go for that? Now, what I've always advocated and what I continue to is that there are such beings that do know what's going on, who do know where peace of mind and safety and enlightenment can be found. They are aware. Cat, come on. Cat wants to be fed. It's just that I haven't been able to find them at this time. But, you know, it's a good time for them to show up with this comet coming in, World War III, on the cusp of World War III, etc. So I have not given up that quest, and what has happened is I've had a further clarification about how they can be useful. And so let us get in the second part of this video, let us get into that. And Kat, you've got to go. Come on. Go. Let us talk about perception, because that is the key. Perception is the key. We believe that our perception is fixed, and that is not true. Perception is arbitrary. It's all imaginary anyway. It's a hallucination. How can hallucinations be truly fixed? What can possibly fix them? You know, they're arbitrary. It's arbitrary. We're just making it up. Is make-believe fixed? It's not. But we try to pretend that it's fixed. Why? Because, again, it comes back to the continuity problem. And the continuity problem is the only problem we have, period. Every single problem that we think we have stems from the continuity problem and is supported by it and is a defense against the fear that we have. This cat is relentless right now. Go. So the continuity problem drives all our problems. So we only have this one problem, which is the fear of disorientation, eternal, never-ending disorientation. That is our fear. So perception is designed to defend against this fear, really. And our belief that our perception is fixed is the prime defense. Like we think, as we look about, as we see everything, we think, oh, yeah, my perception's stable, it's fixed. There's no question that it's fixed, that it's stable. This is what there is to see. We don't even question it. We don't even question it. Now, we are told that our perception is not fixed, and we can change our perception of what we see. That the way that we're seeing everything is based on fear and a desire to defend against that fear. And by seeing things the way that we're seeing them, everything that we see is so dissimilar to reality that we don't even think about reality, and we don't have any inclination to go back to reality, therefore protecting against the continuity problem, disorientation. We feel that if we drop perception, we will be disoriented. So we, our perception of all this stuff is designed to make us to lead us as far away from reality as possible. But our perception isn't stable, but we insist that it is, because we say, no, this is all I have to see, and I can't see anything other than that. You know, this body, these trees, these things, it's all ugly, it really is. But we make pretend, oh, it's beautiful, yeah, it's beautiful. It's all fixed. This is the way it is. It's not true at all. Now, we're told this by the gurus, the great seers, etc. They are able to melt this fixation, this perceptual fixation. We have a perceptual fixation, severe perceptual fixation, thinking that what we're perceiving, that's the only way to perceive it. And it's not true at all. And the seers have told us that no, that it's only a fixation. And you can perceive differently. You can, instead of seeing the tree the way we think we're seeing it, you can see something incredibly beautiful, way more beautiful, that reminds us of reality. We say, hey, this really reminds me of reality. But we don't do that because we're afraid of the continuity problem. Once we realize the Holy Spirit has a vision for us, a perception for us that solves the continuity problem, then we get less afraid to let go of our perceptual fixations. We're suffering from perceptual fixations. We're fixated on seeing things the way that, you know, that defends against going back to reality by seeing something very, very different. So, and ugly and terrible. I mean, just look at all the stuff that the media and the news and the entertainment industry are shoving down everyone's perceptual throats. You know, so much death and violence and sleaze and ugliness is just hideous, you know, absolutely hideous. And people love it. They lap it up. Why? Because it's so dissimilar to reality. They think, oh, they don't even think about reality. You know, it doesn't even enter their mind. Oh, look at all this horrible, horrible war and death, etc. And they just perceptually, they just soak it in like a sponge. But we don't have to do that. We don't have to look at all that terrible stuff. And we don't even have to, we can even see, we can have our perception transformed, actually. For example, instead of seeing a plant, the boundaries, there's a plant. The plant could be like crystalline and giving off scintillation and have beautiful auras to it. And the whole, our whole perception of the planet could be exquisitely beautiful, actually. Just if we let our fixations be, you know, dissolved, our perceptual fixations dissolved. Now, how do we do that? I've tried for a lifetime to do that, and in fact, most of my work with myself and my making videos and a lot of stuff I've done is to try and expand, you know, the perceptual boundaries, to try to get past those blocks. And sometimes in dreaming, a couple nights ago, I was dreaming of this almost like liquid light that was able to just be multi-dimensional beauty and depth, and it was incredible until some idiot jumped up, some like doctor, psychiatrist type of person, and said, hey, you know, we can't do this or something, and that awareness suddenly dissipated. In other words, the perceptual fixation came back, like, no, we're supposed to see things flat, you know, flatlined, everything flatlined. I was having this incredible multi-dimensional, you know, just depth. It was just a wonderful, we can perceive that way, actually, we can, but we're all been brainwashed and conditioned to have this perceptual fixation, flatline perception of death, in other words. So we have to get rid of these fixations. And I found out that there's these wild cards, like these authority complexes within us that tell us, snap back to your perceptual fixation. When you try to expand your perception and get rid of the fixation, that these psychic complexes demand that you get back to your perceptual fixation, which supports their own, supports society. Everybody's doing it, it must be right, must be the way to do it. So now, I've spoken out in the past against drugs. I'm saying that is not the way, because it isn't the way. However, I do sympathize with people who use drugs, who have used drugs, etc. I understand what that's about, because it's an attempt to get past this perceptual these perceptual fixations that we have. It's an attempt to expand perception past, you know, beyond this flatline, dead perceptual fixation that we have. So the people are trying desperately, say, I gotta find a way, you know, and so they use drugs. But there's a lot of problems. It backfires and causes too much trouble. It's not the way. But I sympathize with the inner, you know, frustration and desire to say, how do I get past these fixations, this perceptual fixation? It's awful. You come into this world and you're conditioned, you know, into this flat view of everything that's just horrible. It's just horrible. Where's this rich, multi-dimensional perception that reminds us of reality? Where is that? No, it's terrorized out of us. So, of course, young people, they say, wow, how do I get this back? It's gone. What's happening? You know, and they turn to drugs, try to get it, but that doesn't end well. Doesn't end well. So, not condemning that, I'm just stating the facts that I know to be true. So we do have to melt the perceptual fixation. It does have to be dissolved. We have to go beyond these blocks, perceptual blocks. How do we do this? I've tried everything in my life. So many, many, many things I've tried, and I tried a lot more on this trip. And I have some videos that I will post them. And I've tried to post videos on this channel that try to expand yourself perceptually. More and more beauty, more and more beauty. Get used to the idea of you're seeing just exquisite beauty. Okay, exquisite beauty. But it goes beyond that, because it's still, you're viewing it, it's still flat. But it can go into this multi-dimensional depth of field, like a 360 degree, living, just incredible, rich tapestry of perception. You're not just seeing this thing. No, it's different than that. It can go beyond that. But I try to make available the very best perceptual boundary stretching stuff that I can, and hopefully that leads in the right direction. However, there is one element that we are missing, and that is the guru. Okay, what is the guru? I can tell you this. The real guru is the one where you simply can sit down near them, 100 feet, 200 feet, 300 feet, whatever. In a crowd, could be 1,000 people there, 2,000, 100, doesn't matter, whatever. You just are near them, just be near them. You can stand, you can sit, you can lie down, and simply by being in the presence of the guru, your perceptual fixations begin to dissolve like ice put under the hot desert sun. That is the guru. Okay, their presence melts your perceptual fixations, and you begin to feel the depth, true depth of field of this expansion of perception that sometimes you get in dreams. When you wake up from a dreaming state and you realize, oh my gosh, I was just dreaming in so much incredible depth, all happening at the same time, but not out of control at all. You begin to experience that awaking, like a waking dream. And if you are understanding this, the context of all this and the purpose of it, et cetera, which is this moving towards solving the continuity problem, and then you can just sit there and experience this gradual, beautiful melting away of your perceptual fixations. That's the real guru. You don't have to ask the guru anything. You don't have to talk with them. You don't have to try and figure out, where's my identity, and you know, blah, 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 all this stuff. Not at all. Not at all. The real guru doesn't have to say anything. You can talk about the weather. Talk about sports. You can talk about food. You can just, if you want to, you know. You don't really have to, because what's happening is affecting, literally melting your perceptual fixation. When you're in the presence of the guru, literally melting your perceptual fixations without any necessity for words. Don't matter one way or the other, actually. So that element is still missing. I'd say we have everything except for that. And what happened in the 20th century, when we had the gurus here, was a lot of people were in their presence and they found their perceptual fixations melting, and they didn't really know what to do about it. And they said, "Whoa, you know, this is I don't quite understand, you know, what's going on." And then they kind of said, "Well, maybe I can control this better with drugs. Let me start using drugs. I can work with this that way." You know, and it got too pharmaceutical, and they didn't really understand what's going on. So it didn't work out so great, and it's one of the reasons why we're in the situation now. But though there are those who had a better understanding of it, who could just sit there, like to go to see Ramana Maharshi, he wouldn't say anything. Maybe he would. There are people there that for years he never even spoke to him, never even a word passed at all. And why were they sitting there? Because they were experiencing this continual melting away of perceptual fixation. And it just kept expanding and getting more and more blissful, more and more blissful and blissful and blissful, just by being in the presence of the guru. So this is the element we are lacking. This is the element that we need. The guru is not some, you know, jukebox that you go, "Hey, I want this question answered. I want this question answered." Forget about that. We all have this problem of perceptual fixation. We all have this problem of continuity, problem, fear of disorientation. We all have that severely. But we all need to go beyond this, get beyond this problem, and begin to change our perception, begin to see something that reminds us of reality. Because we don't have to see things the way that we're seeing them right now. We don't have to at all. It's completely arbitrary, actually. But we're fixated there. So we have to get beyond the fixation. And that's where the guru can really help out. Because I have not been able to get beyond it. No matter what I do, it hasn't worked. And I've tried just an incredible amount of things. It hasn't worked. So the one thing that hasn't been tried is the presence of the guru. Because I haven't been able to find one. And we're talking about one whose mere presence, without any words needing to be spoken, or hugs given, or gazes, or anything. No, they can not even be paying any attention to you whatsoever. And you can just be sitting there in their presence. You don't have to even be looking at them or anything. And you can just feel your perceptual fixations just being burned away, melted away. That is the element that we need. And so, understanding that, it puts you in the catbird seat, because when the guru does show up, you know, okay, this is all I have to do. Very simple. There's no panic, you know, no clinging. Say, okay, let's just sit, just sit, just sit, just sit. You know, if you saw Jesus walking this down the street, he'd just say, "Hey, you know, Jesus, sit, please sit down," and just sit. Don't say anything. You don't have to say a word. Don't have to ask questions. Don't have to get answers. Nothing. Just sit in the presence. And they have this entrainment effect where they completely empower and reassure you to step beyond, to melt those perceptual fixations and start seeing, perceiving more and more and more beauty. Because again, all perception is hallucination. All of it. So there's nothing that says you cannot hallucinate a beautiful dream. Nothing. You can. But that will remind you of reality, and then you will put down perception. And we're terrified of that, you see. We're terrified of that. But when we realize that the Holy Spirit can use time to give us a perception of entirely, then we're not so afraid to start going in that direction. Go beyond our perceptual fixations. It won't be such a terrifying thing. You can trust the guru. The guru is right there. The guru has gone beyond. The guru has hallucinated a beautiful dream. They have accepted the Holy Spirit's perception of no loss of identity at all. No perceptible loss of identity. They've done it, and they're there. They're not suffering any disorientation at all. Any feeling of non-functionality, disorientation, no. So you can say, ah, this will work, this will work. So sitting in the presence of the guru is the element that we lack. It's not some mind game. It's not all this stuff that's passing for spiritual teaching, whatever its utility, maybe it has some. But no, it's unnecessary. In the presence of the real, true guru, silence. It just everything happens in silence. Whether you're talking or not, it's happening. And subtly, your perception, you feel more and more empowered to say, I don't have to see the way that I was told, the ego's told me I have to see. I don't have to see that way. In fact, Jesus tells us, you don't even have to see bodies at all. You don't have to see bodies at all. And unto my Ma, they asked her, what are you seeing? When you look at us, what are you seeing? She said, I don't see any flesh at all. I see this beautiful, luminous light, just incredibly beautiful sphere of light is what she saw. She didn't see bodies at all. Why would she want to see bodies? That doesn't remind anyone of reality. It reminds everybody of death. Leads away from it. It's a defense. Seeing bodies is a severe defense against the continuity problem. Severe defense. Certain sign that we are terrified of the continuity problem. So we don't have to see bodies. Physical flesh bodies. We can see these beautiful luminous spheres in this place. Again, all perception is a hallucination. All of it. So we are completely capable of hallucinating a beautiful dream. And the Holy Spirit does it for us. The Holy Spirit, being one with Spirit, our Spirit, is able to use time in a certain way that enables us to have what you might call a perfect hallucination. A hallucination that perfectly solves a continuity problem. So as we're on the cusp of the comet and the World War III and falling into a completely debased situation, all this stuff, and we're desperately trying to expand our perception, get past the perceptual fixations that we have, which will then free us up, and we realize we don't need to see all this ugliness. We don't need to see the war. We don't need to see all this stuff. That's all a perceptual fixation based on fear of the continuity problem. This is what people want to see. They want to see death. They want to see violence. They want to see decadence. They want to see all the terrible stuff, because that doesn't remind them of reality. That's what they want. But there are others who don't want that. They say, I want to be reminded of reality. I want to see beautiful beauty, more and more beauty, enhanced, truly enhanced. I want to see incredible, just the whole world shining, just absolutely shining. I want to see that. They then will not have to see all this stuff, not be tempted by it. They'll get away from it, sidestep it, as it were. Now, if you're truly adept, even in the midst of this, you won't see it. But we're not that adept at this point. So we have to realize where are we at right now. We are struggling just to accept the dissolving of perceptual fixation. That's where we're at. So it's not a good idea for us to put ourselves in a situation of being surrounded by this animalistic, debased, decadent, wicked world that is designed to give us visuals and perception that feed the forgetfulness of reality. That's not good for us. It's not good for us at all. So we deserve the presence of a guru. We deserve it. That's what a guru does, is to help us with this particular situation that we're stuck in right now. That's the whole function of a guru. So we deserve a guru, and we have to keep saying that. We absolutely deserve it. We absolutely deserve the presence of a guru. And again, it will not dissolve into some circus of questioning this, questioning that, grilling. That's not what it's about at all. The guru doesn't have anything to say. It's the presence of the guru and those who know what it's for to dissolve the fixation, perceptual fixation. So you get a sense, you know, you start experiencing, hey, I can go beyond. I can go beyond. I can go beyond perception. I'm not stuck. I don't have to see all this violence and death. I don't have to see it. I can go beyond it. And I can even decide, you know what, I don't even want to dwell on a planet where all this stuff's taking place. I'd rather dwell on a place where it's just, you know, incredibly beautiful, peaceful, nothing is being lost, no loss of identity of anything taking place, which can be, that can be done too. So we're missing the one element, and I keep trying to call the guru, you know, into the scene. You know, we should all do it. We should all do it. We shouldn't be shy about it. You know, just put out the call. Say, hey, guru, it's time. The presence of the guru is requested at this time. You can say that. You don't have to worry about a name. It's not a name because we're going beyond the perceptual fixation of names, bodies, all that kind of stuff. But what we want to see form, the edges, you know, dissolving into beautiful light. We don't want to see this, you know, just this static, linear, flat form perception. We want to go multi-dimensional, true richness. We want to see that happening right now. We want to see it right now. So it doesn't matter, you know, just call the presence of the guru down, that's all. Doesn't who it is, it doesn't make no difference, because it's not really any who there. It's that which has gone beyond the who. It's that which is experienced the hallucination of a perfect perception, perfect dream, who has no fear of the continuity issue anymore whatsoever, has been solved. They've accepted the solution to it. And just that presence, call down the presence of that. And then just sit, you know, just sit there, like an ice cube in the sun. Just put yourself out in the sun, as it were, which I did on this vacation. I really did put myself out in the sun. And I was able to handle it. I was the only person out on the street. There was nobody walking around. It was so hot, but I was out walking around. Got rocked pretty well, that's for sure. handled it. I was able to do it, and I feel fine now. I feel fine. It was tremendous. So I was able to brave the severe heat, you know, put myself out there, and so I'm ready to go. I'm ready to go here. But we need to get it going. Now can the guru do it remotely? I don't know. I'd say everything's possible with the guru. Could it be done through video? I don't know. It's possible. It's possible. We need to find out, because it is strategically, it is somewhat difficult in today's world, you know, for someone's somewhere, for people have to come see them from all over the world. I know that sometimes it happens, but it is tough, because there's a lot of people who simply don't have the means to travel. in a lot of different ways. It may be their age, it may be their dislike of travel, it may be lack of funds to travel, it may have to work, you know, and a lot of different things. They need their family, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So it's just not always possible. So could it be done, you know, through video? Maybe. We'll find out. But it has to be done somehow. Otherwise, how are we going to truly dissolve? People will turn to drugs more and more, as they are doing. I really feel that the lack of gurus in the world is really leading to the severe drug problem in the world. And unfortunately, it is taking on an insane momentum at this time of legalization all over the world, which is really a total breakdown, really, of trust in God, faith in God, faith in the guru, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. They're basically saying, hey, you know, there's no such thing, there's no help, we just have to try to use drugs and do it ourselves, kind of thing. And so that's, drugs don't work. I've known a ton of people who have been, you know, potheads their whole life, and, you know, it's sad, it's really sad. I would think that people, before they get into that, would look at the older generation, those who've been doing it for, you know, 40 years, and assess the situation. Hey, you know, is this how I want to be in 40 years? Really? You know? No. I've never seen anyone who used drugs that I would want to follow and say, hey, you know, this is what works. Never. So, unfortunately, because we don't have this option of the gurus, it's not there in strong enough way that people are just self-medicating. They're saying, well, I got to find some way to go beyond these perceptual fixations. And they're you know, doing stuff that doesn't work. It's just like meth is a way to go beyond the physical fixations of what can I do. You know, people want to be Superman. They say, I should be able to just function, you know, incredibly well and never sleep and all this stuff. Which is, that's another fixation of what we can do physically too, or just actively our minds, etc. We're taught that this is our limits or something. So people want to break through those limits. They want to feel like they can just run up a mountain or something. And so they use drugs to in that way too. It's just drugs are used to try to push through limitations, fixations in all different directions, but with devastating effects, side effects, and etc. So I've always maintained that the guru is essential, and yet the guru hasn't shown up, which is you know, tough to swallow, to say the least, because nobody's succeeding. We're not succeeding. We're failing. And if the guru did show up, I believe we would succeed. So, you know, just keep trying to convince the guru. Come on, you know, the presence of that. Show up here. Help be a nexus, be a starting point, be a crystallization. You know, crystallization starts from a starting point. An oyster starts from a little grain of sand or something, a pearl. You know, a pearl starts from a grain of sand, an oyster, etc. Needs to be that centerpiece where the pearl grows around that centerpiece. And and again, the whole thing is going to be dissolving those perceptual fixations. It's got nothing to do with anything else, really. I know the ego will spin it in every possible way other than what it's really about. It's about going, it's all about perception. And it's all about realizing our perception is fluid. It's not fixed. It is not fixed. We are insisting on trying to fixate it. We're fixated in a state of fixation, as it were. We have all these authority figures telling us, and we've internalized these authority figures, and they work as like psychic guardians of our fixation. And every time we try to go beyond it, we get, hey, you can't do that, you know. Ah. So, and again, but we can get into that some other time. Let's not put too much on the plate. We've had all this stuff, the Aldous Huxley and the Wasserman thing and doors of perception, and this has been going on since the 50s. So it's been going on, how long? 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, the 2000, 63, 660, over 60 years of a great struggle to find some way past these fixations. But what we're finding out is that when you dissolve perceptual fixation, you can go one of two ways. You can go in the way which is towards greater beauty and light, which reminds you of reality, or you can go down into darker and darker areas which don't remind you of reality, are much more, or more and more dissimilar to reality, and then end up being fixated even in even greater darkness. And that's what's happened in the world. There have been a lot of dissolving of fixations for the purpose of lowering the planet down even lower to get even into darker forgetfulness of reality. That's what's actually happened. And that's happening all over the planet right now. And of course it's being marketed as you are getting past your perceptual fixations. You're progressing. It's the progressive movement. If you're progressing, you're letting go of your fixations, your terrible fixations, but it's for the purpose of lowering you down into even some more severe forgetfulness. So you have to dissolve the fixations with the direction and intent to be reminded, go towards more remembrance of reality, not towards more forgetfulness. So that's why people who take drugs, they can have very bad trips, they can have some good trips for a while, and then they can have extremely negative trips that really severely freak them out. Because what happens is when the drug does the dissolving of perceptual fixations, you are not in control, you don't have the context, etc., and you can easily get entrained into a very negative darkness and get pulled down into severe darkness and then get fixated there, and then that's really bad. So one has to, the presence of the guru prevents that. You see, the presence of the guru dissolving it entrains you automatically. It entrains you to go towards the remembrance of reality and let your perception be a beautiful, enriched perception. Now, why do we reject the guru here in the West, is the question. Because there are very powerful interests at work in the West that don't want you to have a guru. They want you to use pharmaceuticals, okay? The pharmaceutical industry and its tentacles through all our lives, in so many ways, the whole chemical, pharmaceutical conglomerates, etc., etc., have incredible power, actually, and have sponsored the entertainment, the news, the mass culture, the music, all that stuff. They're actually the ones behind it and the West, and they have built up this massive psychic complex in us which rejects the presence of a guru and rejects our attempt to free ourselves from perceptual fixations and to begin to perceive more and more multidimensionally, more and more beautifully. And they tell us that no, you can't do it that way. You have to do it through pharmaceuticals. See? And that is the problem. In other words, you have to pay them. So you become like a junkie, as it were. So it is truly that is what's behind the problem. The guru's not showing up here. Because obviously, if you could get this multidimensionality and fast perceptual fixation simply by sitting in the presence of Guru, you don't need any pharmaceuticals. In fact, you'd say, nah. So, you know, they don't want that. Obviously, the shareholders, those who live on the dividends of all these companies and constant marketing of all this medicines and everything that's based on our perceptual fixations and the fear of the continuity issue, and the whole thing just feeds the profits of all these companies that are involved in the greater massive conglomerate, world conglomerate of pharmaceuticals, chemicals, etc., etc. So we have this inner prohibition against turning to the guru. We feel that somehow betraying something or going against the better interests of society or just so brainwashed, really, in the web. We are so brainwashed, we don't even realize how brainwashed we are. You know, do you think Coca-Cola wants us to be able to melt perceptual fixation and hallucinate a beautiful dream? No, they want you to drink Coca-Cola and feel that Coke adds life, that it's the real thing. That it's the real thing. So the stockholders, you know, can live off their, you know, the profits of their stocks and etc. It's the whole way it's all set up. And so it's a tremendous problem here, actually. And it's leading people down into World War III. Because once people realize, hey, that we can get beyond it simply spiritually, people put down their weapons and say, hey, what are we fighting for? It's ridiculous. I want to sit down. I want to get beyond these perceptual fixations. I can just do it by sitting in the presence of this guru. That's amazing, you know. Forget it. I'm not fighting anybody. I'm not going to war. I'm not going to go buy these products and stuff. Forget it. And so the whole world has become debased, really. Materialistic, commercialized, materialistic, relying on these products, thinking that they will help us go beyond, get what we want. All the advertising is based on this. They exploit this situation. They know how to exploit it. They're very adept at exploiting it and making us believe and associate certain products with, hey, this will help me get beyond, you know, the perceptual fixation. This terrible feeling of living in flatland, you know, flatland of fear. So we really have not gotten the guru here in the West. We really haven't. But we need one. We need one. You know, and somehow we have to just realize that there's this enormous attempt to prohibit it, but that has to happen anyway. And it's for their own good, you know. The people living off the dividends of all this stuff, they have to go beyond their fixations too at some point. And they, you know, they have to see that it's possible. So at any rate, the guru has to show up. That's the missing element of these times that we're in. It's the missing element. It's been missing for quite some time. And maybe it's not possible the guru shows up in the West. I don't know. Maybe we have to go somewhere where the guru is not, we're not so in the grip of that. That is possible. I don't know. But whatever has to happen now. Because this comet is coming in. World War III is likely to break out soon. As I think everybody realizes, things are not getting better in the Middle East. They are deteriorating in an extreme way. The superpowers are showing that they are not going to back down from one another. Okay? China, Russia, United States are not going to back down from one another. So you have a situation there that is just, you know, going to happen. Very, very likely happen. And we don't want to, we want to already go beyond our perceptual fixation before that happens. So that we can just, you know, say, I don't need that. There's nothing to see there. Nothing to see there, and I don't need to see it. I've already gone beyond it. Already gone beyond it. So we need that to happen now. And I'm doing everything possible to try and to help that come about. And I know all of you are also, in your own way, realizing we have to make this breakthrough now. You know, it's August, it's still the month of breakthroughs, so we're still giving it everything we got right now. So I'll post this video, and there will be some other videos maybe that are just for you to help chill out, calm down, mellow out, take a ride with me. I did some taping, driving, just a ride. And you can just relax. And it might even help begin to soften up, you know, your perceptual fixation. Saying, hey, I don't really have to hold on to this. Not really. I can gradually, gently expand it and let it go. So this is something we have to do. Has to be done. And the sooner the better. Okay, let's do it. That's it.